We will reconvene. There is some confusion about whether there will be another vote. I'll know in about 5 or 6 minutes, but I thought that I would come back and reconvene this portion, which will be a briefing. And if there is another vote, I will then have to leave again. We will now hear from our two witnesses from the government of Southern Sudan. As I indicated, this will be a briefing. Luka Bang Den, who is Minister for Presidential Affairs, and Barnaba Benjamin, who is Minister for Regional Cooperation. I ask that you keep your remarks brief to 10 minutes, perhaps. We will have time for dialogue and questions after your presentation. You both have submitted very comprehensive testimonies, which we will enter into the record without objection. It will be very useful to review. And we thank you again for those testimonies. If the two witnesses will come up to the table, Minister Deng. We certainly appreciate you coming here to this, to brief us here in the Africa and Global Health Subcommittee. We commend you for the opening of the mission of South Sudan recently, and we look forward to working closely with the mission. At this time, we will hear from the Minister for Presidential Affairs. Would you, there's a mic button, if you would press that. Thank you.
Thanks a lot for giving us this opportunity. Just to be on the record, we have a lengthy presentation and we meant for circulation, and we hope that you will consider it for the record.
Without objection.
Equally, we have the speech of the of our president, Salva Kiir Mayardit, on the 9th of January, and we believe it's a very important document that will complement also our testimony and hearing here.
We'll enter it without objection.
First, one is really so delighted of having this opportunity, and probably it's an extension of the solidarity of the peoples of this country and the people of Southern Sudan. But in particular, we really want to extend our appreciation to your chair for giving us this opportunity. On behalf of the people of Southern Sudan and their president, we would like to extend our appreciation for the long-standing position of the U.S. government and the people of U.S. for standing during the difficult times of war and during the negotiation, which resulted in good peace that we are talking about today. And also engaging today also in facilitating the reconstruction of Southern Sudan. In particular, we want also to extend our appreciation and bring thanks to President George Bush for his personal involvement in Sudan, and that would help a lot in keeping the Sudan in the heart of the American people and maintaining daily interest in peace in Sudan. What I will do, I will try to highlight some of the few points that I believe are, I have a PowerPoint presentation. You may not see it properly, but I will just go into the, I think I would like, first I would like to start with the comprehensive peace agreement that we have been talking about.
Would there be any way to dim the lights here, if anyone knows whether that can happen?
We believe the comprehensive peace agreement is one of the biggest achievements in the Sudan and indeed in Africa. But importantly, I think it is one of the outstanding successes of the American foreign policy in ending a brutal and protracted war that claimed 2 million lives and displaced more than 4 million persons. In fact, a CPA is not only a solid win to people of Sudan, but it equally contributes as well to regional stability and containment of terrorist activities in the region. Our coming here, Mr. Chairman, is we believe this CPA is now at risk, and we are loudly ringing an alarm bell and a wake-up call to American people and their government to refocus their attention to CPA to protect it and save it. One of the good, I would like just to highlight some of the main features of the CPA. The fact that one being in war, negotiating the peace, drafting most of the constitutions, but also becoming now a key player in implementing the CPA. And I would like to highlight some of the few points for this hearing. I think the most important achievement of the CPA is the very fact that it attempts to address the rural marginalization in Sudan. And also is an effort to transform Sudan through the vision of the new Sudan. And I think a vision of new Sudan is around the main values upon which this country is equally also based their governance. One of the good things is that the redefinition of a Sudan with the CPA has been redefined away from Arabo-Islam paradigm, and now is based on cultural, religious, and ethnic diversity as a foundation for national cohesion. And I think this is very important in the sense that whenever you talk about Sudan, people tend to look at Sudan Islam, Sudan as Arab country, but with the CPA, we have redefined the country. What we witness also in Sudan after the signing of the CPA is a constitutional transformation based on adoption of Bill of Rights and recognition of sovereign authority of people. And I think this is a very, Sudan, we have never tested the national building in Sudan, but with CPA, we managed to engage in defining and laying the very important foundation for the governance and the national building. Right of self-determination for the people of Southern Sudan is one of the major achievements whereby the people have been asked for the first time to shake the unity of Sudan based on their free will. And I think I will highlight some of these things based on our work also with National Democratic Institute and what was echoed earlier by Roger Winter. And we should not also forget one of the good achievements of the CPA is the issue of the three areas, Nuba Mountains, Southern Blue Nile, and Abyei area. These people, they have admired and they engage with the people of Southern Sudan in the fight for their dignity and freedom, and the CPA managed to give them what they intended to have. That's the self-rule and popular consultation. In particular, Nuba Mountains, people of Nuba Mountains were aspiring to have the right of self-determination like people of Southern Sudan. Also, in CPA, there's a very considerable economic efforts to transform and the economic setup of Sudan to combat poverty and attain Millennium Development Goals. And this is to be reflected in increased revenue transfer to the subnational levels. And the last point about the CPA achievement is the foreign policy transformation, away from antagonism to promote peace, cooperation, and combat all forms of terrorism. So these are basically the main aspects of the CPA. I just would like to highlight some of the challenges before that. Being in Sudan and seeing through the implementation of the CPA, one should recognize a considerable achievement in Sudan with the CPA. In particular, the very fact there is a relative peace now in Sudan, especially in southern Sudan. Despite the fact we have some skirmishes here and there, but on average, I think we have achieved a lot in terms of stability and security in southern Sudan. As also mentioned by Wolf earlier, even if you see the people have taken this peace seriously, and they have started normalizing their livelihoods, and they started reconstruction of their farms or their houses, which are all indication that people are believing in peace and they want to make it a reality in their own way. Yet, there are some challenges, and I would like to highlight some of the points raised earlier by Roger about the selective intention of not to implement certain provisions of the CPA. The most important challenge is the anti-CPA members of the National Congress Party, especially the Islamists. I think for some of us, when we went into war and we conclude the peace, we thought the CPA should give a chance for the National Congress Party, especially the extremists, for them to reform and to smoothly get into the normal democratic transformation in Sudan. But seeing them through, I came to believe these the anti-CPA members of the National Congress Party are now in the reign and in the control of affairs. And I could attribute most of the delay to their deliberate strategy of derailing the implementation of the CPA. The second challenge is about the militia and LRA. In the agreement, as mentioned earlier, is one of the very meticulously drafted agreement with detailed information. And in the CPA, we clearly spell out that the militia should not exist, and they should be integrated either to the Sudan Armed Forces or to the SPLA, or integrated into the communities through the DDR program. But as we talk today, still we have about 20,000 militias at large with the support of the Sudan Armed Forces, as mentioned by our president in his speech. And this is really a real flashpoint which could refocus and taking the focus of government of Southern Sudan away from delivering the service to the people. LRA, as you know, we took it upon ourselves to, as a government of Southern Sudan, to provide and make peace in the region, especially in Uganda. But that one was at a high cost. LRA, for us, we stand firmly with the international community about the atrocity that they committed. And from the initial stage, after the formation of the government of Southern Sudan, we gave them options, either to talk peace with the Ugandan government or to leave Southern Sudan. And based on those understanding that we managed to mediate and facilitate these peace talks. But we learn with dismay that the LRA is trying to use this platform of the peace talks to access the media and press coverage. And that's why our president, in the speech on the 9th of January, sent a very clear message to LRA. Either they talk peace or they leave Southern Sudan. But we are aware about the atrocity committed by LRA. Another challenge is the ABA protocol. Maybe, Mr. Sherman, I would like to spend some few minutes here on ABA protocol, because it is one of the real challenges which can take us back to the war. And I would go that to the fact that ABA is one of the areas whereby the Second Civil War started. And the provisions of the ABA protocol are clearly defined, very simple and straightforward. We agreed in the CPA that ABA people, they will have a special status under the presidency. And we have agreed also this community, because they are at the border between the north and the south, they will have a dual citizenship so that they can enjoy the rights of being southerners as well as northern Sudanese. But they were given a right of a referendum to decide their administrative setup, where should it be. And in the agreement, we agreed also that we will be establishing a BA Boundaries Commission with experts on of which US government was represented on the BA Boundaries Commission. And this commission was mandated by the CPA to come up with the recommendations, and these recommendations should be final and binding. And they were tasked and mandated to go and define and demarcate the areas of Ngok Dinka, who were transferred in 1905 to Northern Sudan against their will and for the administrative convenience by the colonial authorities. The commission finished their work, and they came back with a report to the presidency. What is happening is that the anti-CPA extremists of the National Congress Party misinformed or deliberately intended to not implement the CPA. And they are saying the following, that the experts have exceeded their mandate. And what mandate? They came clearly and they demarcate and define the area of the 9 chiefdoms of Ngok Dinka. And they said they did not also find the maps of 1905, and which is actually not consistent with the provision of the CPA. Because people are not asking to look for a map, and people are looking for the place where these people were living. But the intention, as echoed by Roger, is a deliberate intention for containment and then controlling the oil resources. Abia area is actually producing about 25% to 30% of the oil production in Sudan. And that's of strategic interest for them. And they know very well the very fact they are not handling the people of Abia in a good way. They believe that later on the referendum, they may opt to go to join the South. So it's an area that, and also beside the fact that it is one of the texts actually drafted by the US government, which resulted into the conclusion of the peace agreement. The other challenge is the CPA monitoring mechanisms. We have provided in the CPA the establishment of assessment and evaluation commission, of which US government is well represented. But what we have seen of late, this assessment and evaluation commission is not effective enough, first because of the representation, secondly because they don't have a punitive measures that they can effect when there is any violations of the CPA. Maybe I will talk later on about the key messages. And also we have what is called ceasefire political commission, of which the UN is represented, but also the National Congress Party, especially the anti-CPA members, decided not to allow these two mechanisms to work effectively. The other point is North-South Border Committee. I had a meeting before my coming here with the members of this committee. Besides the fact also I had a chance of meeting the Assessment and Evaluation Commission. They are deliberately under-resourced. They are not given the necessary budget so that they can perform their work. And the intention is very clear. One, the North-South Border Committee will determine and demarcate the North-South border line, which is going to be the basis upon which we are going to redeploy the forces, the excess forces of the Sudan Armed Forces, those forces exceeding the joint integrated units. And second, the determination of oil fields. And as most of the oil field, based on the National Congress Party definition of the North-South border, they have redefined the border in such a way most of the oil fields are defined in the Northern Sudan. And this has a profound impact on the flow of oil revenue to the South. Despite the fact President Bashir mentioned that they are going to recalculate after the definition of the North-South border to see whether these oil fields are wrongly redefined or put into the Northern Sudan. But yet the South needed these resources now. And the other one is the population census. As you know, population census, we have agreed to have it by the end of this year or early next year, and you cannot have a population census without the clear boundaries. Probably by delaying the north-south border, you will affect also the democratic transformation through the general elections. And that's why it's very critical how best you can push the work of the committee. And the other challenge is the oil sector itself, which is still, the government, the NCP component of the government, they have started providing the information about the production, the marketing, and the, because we set up a joint committee. But what is clear is that—
Excuse me, we have 4 minutes to go to vote. We should be able to be back in 6 or 7 minutes because we'll get there and come right back. So okay. We'll conclude with you and then hear our second